first proposition we're going to talk to with our member of the league is the redistricting reform, and then there's another one with the clean air water issue, another one with same-day voter, absentee voting, another one with down in New York City, we don't care about that, increasing their court of claims, their civil claims, accordingly to the dollar amount. And then utilization of monies for payroll in Ulster County, it affects budget transfers. So those are the propositions that we'll talk about with the league representative. Maura, are you online from the League of Women Voters? Good morning.
Good morning, Shane. I'm happy to be online with you. Yes.
Thank you very much, and thank you for taking the time. We have the second half hour is all yours and Mark's. So let's get into it first. Tell us who you are and who you represent and what we're going to be covering, as I stated, with these propositions, with the first one being the proposition about the redistricting. But go ahead, tell us who you are first.
Yeah, thank you so much for giving us some time while we're in the middle of early voting. Right now, which is the perfect time to engage everyone. I'm the vice president of the Mid-Hudson League of Women Voters, and we cover Orange, Ulster, and Dutchess counties. When I explain to people that I am very politically engaged but am nonpartisan, these days people kind of look at me funny and scratch their head, and that's a sign of the times. It's not where the league's always been. We've been around over 100 years, and of course we, as you know, Shane, spend our time and our efforts engaging the electorate, engaging people to be educated about what's on the ballot, who's running. We do sessions that talk about what does a comptroller do and what is that role, so they understand mm-hmm. not just who the candidates are, but what the roles are. Mm-hmm. This year in particular, of course, is a difficult year for engagement because it's after the big show, right? After a presidential year, it's always a heavy lift for people to do get out the vote. But of course, we're doing our get out the vote efforts. And we've had two educational seminars in the last 2 weeks about this year's election. They're, by the way, recorded in on our website, which is lwvmidhudson.org. And one of them was particular to the back of the ballot propositions. And from what I hear from the people that are working the early voting locations, they say that people who are coming in to vote are taking longer time at the, you know, behind the privacy panel on the tables because they have to read the sentences five times over. Proposition one is this huge run-on sentence with really big, you know, ideas in it, and people are asking a lot of questions, which I'm glad they do, but it's great to ask the questions now, have a chance to look over some information. Because the league is nonpartisan, we have put out a wonderful publication for New York State that's called The Voter's Guide, that has no positions. It just says, here are the pros and cons for each of the five propositions. Here is how it will read on the ballot. We do have opinions about some of them that I'm happy to share. However, it's really just about understanding what it is and understanding both sides of the argument. And that's where I spend my time and that's where I spend my efforts. And I'm so grateful to shows like yours that will allow us to be in that space, Shane.
No, thank you. In the first hour, see, you're doing what we try to do in the first hour, Maura, which is to try to explain to the public what the role of a legislative branch is, what the role of that branch of government is. And it's about checks and balances, it's about oversight, it's about legislating, it's about appropriation, it's about representation. And I agree with you. The league is invaluable because it is trying to foster not just what we should think, but how we should think about an issue. And basically, yeah, and okay, what the pros and cons. Right. You should think about it, but how we go about it and looking at the pros and the cons and trying to get the politics out. So we thank you for that. Mm-hmm. So that's a good segue into a very political proposition, which is the redistricting plan, which, fast forward, I'd have to agree with the Board of Election Commissioner Quigley. I think this is just more than Senate packing with the way that they want to try to get around the current process. But explain to our listeners what this redistricting reform is, because before you do that, you might remember, okay, where Senator Amador became a senator because of this kind of shenanigans. Okay, back mm-hmm. in 2010, where the governor needed an extra vote for his budget and for his ethics reform. So what he did was, is we, Ulster County, got another senator back then. Okay, so this is more than a game. This has effect for us with representation in terms of the tax dollars we contribute, whether we're going to get them back, what kind of services we're going to get from our state government. So on the one hand, the representation that we have gotten from the new Senate seat is good, I guess. But on the other hand, it just reeks of politics for the governor and other members of the legislature to control the process. So speak to the proposal, Maura, but I'm giving our listeners a background as to why this is very important for them to consider how districts are drawn. Go ahead.
Yeah. And I would like to actually read the language as it appears on the ballot, because it asks a yes or no question: shall the proposed amendment be approved? And I just kind of want to say it so people understand, you know, so when they see it, they understand it. It says this proposed constitutional amendment would freeze the number of state senators at 63, amend the process for the counting of the state's population, delete certain provisions that violate United States Constitution, repeal and amend certain requirements for the appointment of the co-executive directors of the redistricting commission, and amend the matter of drawing district lines for congressional and state legislative offices. Shall the proposed amendment be approved? And, you know, those words, apportionment, redistricting, sometimes that can be confusing, but I think a lot of people know what gerrymandering is, and they don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
And so the league does have a position on Proposition 1, the New York State League of Women Voters, which is we are opposed, actually, to this one. It's a power grab, if you will. It's keeping the party that they control in a place that is not allowing the other voices to be heard. Just listening to your show earlier, Shane, you were talking about a couple of different local races that were the candidates are unopposed. I believe opposition builds accountability. I believe opposition creates a better conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we want to have all the voices heard. And mm-hmm. so it's not to say that we are against the party who is in power, et cetera. We're saying we don't have any horses in the race. We want to make sure everybody's heard and being part of that process. So mm-hmm. That's the reason why we feel it would unfairly empower the majority party by preventing the minor party from having input into the proposed maps. And we know the maps are going to be redrawn significantly. There are things about it we like, and I do want to address that. Like, the pro for us is the way that we are counting incarcerated individuals
mm-hmm.
would be changed. So the pro to this amendment would be the current New York state law requires incarcerated individuals to be counted as living in their last place of residence and not prison for purposes of redistricting. That would be constitutionalized if this was a yes on this. So that's, we kind of think like that's fair. You know, if you take people from the communities where they live and you count them up in Utica, which is, you know, a very sparsely populated area, and you're counting the prison population, that seems unfair to us. So we actually like parts of it. I mean, that's the thing. We mm-hmm. like parts of it. We don't like parts of it. But because overall, freezing it at 63 would take some voices out of the decision-making process, that's what we stand against it.
What you're saying is you in agreement with what I stated earlier, Maura, that it is a version of Senate packing. It is a very polite version of gerrymandering, and it keeps the existing status quo. So that said, and I really appreciate the way you break it down. You're not saying we're for it. You're giving the pros and cons, but you're really coming down in a very intelligent, thoughtful manner about what the cons are, okay, and what the outcome. So the second proposition. Go ahead. Yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Let me just say, there's two co-executive directors of the commission,
mm-hmm.
and the amendment as proposed takes away the voting rights of the minority-appointed commission members by appointing two directors from the same party. I think that's kind of the easy way to think about it.
I know. And you know, it's interesting. Thank you for reminding, because I have that in my notes and I didn't note it. Thank you. Because Ashley Diddes, the Board of Elections Commissioner, said, well, the Democrats are worried about losing the Senate. That should be enough for everyone to vote no. Because that's self-dealing right there. And I'm surprised that she actually stated that publicly, notwithstanding her candor. But getting back to Proposition 2, the clean air and war. Now, I'm looking at this from the standpoint of standing, which you didn't. I'm going to get into after I hear what your understanding of it is and the pros and cons of it. Go ahead.
Okay. So here's the thing. It's the right to clean air, clean water, and a healthful environment. I mean, who's going to... I can't vote against the environment being important and clean water being important. So right. I think in generally, and everyone I talk to is like, yes, environment, yes. And the League of Women Voters has a very strong environmental platform, and we always support environmental rights. What's really unclear is, what the heck does this do in terms of codifying law? Because it's not really specific. The question right. as it appears says that it's going to amend Article 1 of the New York Constitution to establish the right of each person to clean air, water, and a healthful environment. So there is concern that this could bring frivolous lawsuits against companies, perhaps. You know, my question I posed to someone in Albany was, does this mean that we would get FEMA money or disaster money more quickly, knowing that this particular area lately with the superstorms, et cetera, all the climate change that has brought floods to this area and water, you were talking about clean water and our infrastructure, would that get us access to money more quickly? And they were like, I don't know. Nobody knows. And so there's a lot of just shrugging about it. So I think, you know, we have taken a position on this, that we are for this because we are for environmental rights. We just don't really know how it will become actionable with the citizenry. So there's a lot of just ambiguity, I think, is what I'd say about this one. But I don't think it's a big con, but it's, you know, the litigiousness you would probably be able to speak to better, Shayne, than I would.
I think you're on point, and I agree with you. I mean, who would be opposed to having a right to clean air and clean water other than a buffoon and someone who makes a lot of money from a stock portfolio in the fossil fuel industry? But the point I'm trying to make, joke and flip it aside, I agree with you. The concern I have is that what's the standing? First of all, how are we going to enforce it? What's the standing? Like, for instance, I'm a New York City resident. I'm walking, wading through 6 feet of water trying to get to my job in the subway. Hey, how you doing? All right. I become injured because of the toxic crap that's in there. All right. I'm in the city of Kingston, resident. Something happened. You know, my sewer backs up. Okay. In my basement, we end up getting mold and we end up getting sick. Okay. Now, what do we do? We have a right under Article 1 now, as amended. But what's the standing? And standing, folks, where Maura and I are trying to struggle with, in legal terms, in simple terms, means that you have to show an injury traceable in fact that actually, okay, would connect you to your own legal rights. So there has to be a nexus, a connection to the law. So, okay, Shayne Gallo, okay, has a connection because he has a right to clean air and write. Well, what's his injury? Well, I'm subject to the sewage or whatever. Okay, is that an injury? In fact, okay, and what's my remedy? So, not to complicate it, but what we're talking about are two issues in simple terms. How is it enforced, and what is the standing right to sue when you're aggrieved by unclean air, unclean water? And to your point, this is where the league is valuable to try to impress upon the Senate and the Assembly legislators and their counsel that this is all well-intended, or the governor's office counsel. This is well-intended, but where is going to be the enforcement, and how are people going to be able to sue, okay, for their right? So that's good. Now, what about now Proposition 4, excuse me, which is the next one, I'm sorry, which is the same-day voter absentee voting and implementation issue?
Well, you're talking to someone who is all about access to voting rights. So,
okay. I agree with that. Go ahead. Go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, and I have, you know, worked for the Board of Elections on those days when people walk in and you hear the whole life story and how the calendar affected their ability to vote and voting by affidavit and all these
things. So you're a polling inspector. You're a polling inspector. You were a polling inspector.
No? Not this year, but prior to.
Okay, yeah. Cool. Go ahead.
Yeah. So we always want people to be able to engage about. So we're for that. And the next one, proposal number 4, is also about voting. What it's doing is codifying the no excuse absentee ballot voting rights, which has been put in place by executive order the last 2 years, and this is just saying we're going to stick with it. So both of those, to me, access to voting are yeses.
Excellent. And I agree for those reasons. Then we can key into Mark in a minute or two as to the concerns people have about early voting, absentee voting with the election security issue. So New York City, they can have their increase to 50,000. I really could care less. That's all right. The other one, though, well, I don't. Go ahead.
Shane, I'll see what I mean. We have to vote on the New York City thing because it's a New York state law.
Oh, no, I understand.
I think it does impact us because get them out of the New York State Supreme Court system because the wait is so tremendous and it's such an arduous process. So if we can lighten that load and get our own people have access to the state Supreme Court faster because they're not.
That has no, but with all due respect, New York City's court system and those who are aggrieved from whatever issue has nothing to do with our local court system, the Supreme Court's calendar. Unless I'm wrong and they're transferring those civil claims up to the jurisdiction here in Ulster Supreme Court. So I'm going to have to disagree with you with that, okay, as the impact, okay, on Ulster County up here accordingly if they raise their level of civil claim.
Right, it doesn't come up to us. But,
No. Right, so let's get back then, focus on this utilization. I don't understand this. It says utilization of budget for payroll, and then it says Ulster County, and something I read, and it has something to do with budget transfers. Could you explain that proposition? I think it's proposition number 6.
I don't have enough information to speak to it, Shane.
Got you.
I'm here for the big state 5. And we have 3 counties, Orange, Ulster, and Dutchess, and there's a couple of different municipalities that have back of the ballots and counties, and I don't know all of them in all 3 counties, so I apologize. I don't want to.
No. We're all pleased with what you've done, Maura. You ladies have your hands full there. Thank you. We appreciate it. But with that in mind, let me ask you quickly here. Now, what the heck did I wanted to ask you? The local propositions, the one that's really catching, I think, people's attention is in the town of Ulster with the controller proposition. Okay. Now, how do you weigh in on that? Okay, for instance, the local propositions. If you just want to get skinny quickly for our listeners who do reside in those areas outside of Kingston,
we have not taken a position on it.
Okay.
As I mentioned, we have had educational sessions where, and I don't mean to pick on the comptroller, but we talk about the different roles of different county officials and what their roles are. And to be honest, that one is always like the one that people are not really sure what's the role, scope, and authority. You know, so we talk about what a county legislator does, and we talk about the different judicial roles and their jurisdiction, and we talk about the comptroller. And I think a lot of people don't have a real handle on what that role, scope, and authority is, and I think they're starting to pay attention more. Mm-hmm. And so that's where I stay in the educational space of what you should expect from the people that hold that position.
Well, thank you. And I got it. Before we get to Mark, we have a caller. It's Jean. Jean Jacobs called in. She's got a question for you, Maura. How to get more people to vote? 8,000 people did not vote in the last mayoral election here in Kingston, which could have been the difference between what exists now and what would have been a different outcome.
Yeah. I mean, we've had so many recounts and close elections, you know, that have come down to 2-digit counts and 3-digit counts. And Mark Lindeman can talk a little bit more about recounts and how that process rolls out. I wish there's no magic wand for how to get more people out to vote, especially this year with the ballot proposition probably being the most exciting thing because so many people are unopposed. The last year, of course, it was health concerns, and you know what we were trying to do is make sure people get their absentee ballot and understand how to mail it in, or if they wanted to drop it off, how to drop it off, and them to be engaged and understand it. I think for a lot of people, there's so much political noise that they're tuning out, and that's a different conversation to have. You know, if people stop having faith in the process, that's the thing that's keeping them from voting, then that's discouraging. And actually, that's why I'm so excited, Shane, that you're going to give some time to verified voting, because some people say to me, I don't believe in the system anymore, or I don't think my vote matters. And I happen to hold the opinion that in this part of New York State in particular, that we have a really tight system, and that we really should and can believe in the results of our elections and those recounts and all of those things. And I'd like for people to know that, because I think there's so much media conversations about other parts of the country and the way different states are running their elections that gets people alarmed about what might be happening here. And I actually think we're in a really enviable place. And you've mentioned both of the commissioners of elections, John and Ashley. They are so collaborative with me. I ask them for time on Saturdays. I ask them for evenings. They're always yes, yes. Right. They work on projects together. I mean, we are really lucky, I feel, in this area to have such a strong engagement, and I would love people to
agree.
Know,
you know
more about that.
We're running out of time, and I got here late because of forgetting my notes, and maybe Adam will give me a minute or two beyond the date. But Mark is on. Mark, please. The election security issues of fraud, disease last year, mail-in early, people are worried about internet, hackers, the Russians. The Europeans seem to do it better. There's threats to our voting system that we're kind of implying, Maura and I. Security is more than just voting machines, and audit and paper trails are necessary. So, Mark, tell us who you are in the last 5 minutes, please, and then some of your thoughts about this. And I can always bring you back next week as kind of a follow-up about the outcome of the election to let people know that it was a secure election. Go ahead, sir. Who are you? And then if you could address this quickly. Thank you. I'm sorry to compress you in this last few minutes.
Hey, stuff happens.
Mark, I'm sorry, who?
Mark Lindemann.
Thank you, sir.
Not Linderman, but until very recently lived in Kingston.
Yes, sir.
But I'm a director at Verified Voting, which is a national nonprofit organization. I just happen to be here. And our mission is to strengthen democracy for all voters by promoting the responsible use of technology in elections. So, yeah, our signature issue is paper ballots, because back in 2004, it looked like paperless electronic voting machines were going to kind of take over this part of the world. And computer scientists said, hey, we love computers, but that's a terrible idea. So they started this organization where I now work to turn that around. And so we advocate for paper ballots against internet voting. We advocate for tight controls on the ballots and for audits and recounts to make sure the ballots were counted correctly, all those things.
So we have, to your knowledge, and again, I'm so, so sorry to compress this, we have, to your knowledge, a sound, safe, electoral, secure system for voting, in your opinion, here in Ulster County?
On our national map, New York is not an area of high concern. We have the paper ballots. Most people are voting hand-marked paper ballots. There's an alternative for voters who need it. We're doing really good routine audits. And I agree with everything Maura said about how bipartisan election administration's working, especially in Ulster. So you don't have just Democrats or just Republicans running around with the ballots. Ballot storage regulations and laws are good. So there's an awful lot to like about election administration in New York. There absolutely is.
What about the allegations? And I know when I voted recently, and a family member, it used to be you signed the book. Now you're using an iPad. And there's concern about signature and authentic, you know, verification. Could you speak to that?
Yeah, so signature verification, happens for early voting, and the whole e-poll book thing, as you said, is spreading. It creates some complications. What I think is, it may be possible for someone to sneak through this way, but it's very, very hard for lots of people to sneak through this way. So when computer scientists think about the problem, we don't want a system where we prevent anyone from voting illegally anywhere by making it really, really hard for anyone to vote. We're looking for a system that really provides an effective deterrent. There's just not a lot of incentive to vote illegally because you could get caught, and it's really, really hard to scale up. So it's really hard to steal an election by having people sign wonky names on iPads. It just doesn't work.
So you feel, in summary, Mark, that based on the paper trail, the audits, the electronic signature, the process they have in place, the early voting, that it's unlikely that we would have fraud or any other kind of hanky-panky in this county. Is that your feeling, basically?
Super hard to get away with it.
Well, what I'm going to do, Mark, and I really appreciate it, Mr. Lindemann, thank you very much, and I'm sorry again for the compressing of the time. I'll get you back here in a couple of weeks to do a special segment on this, because I think this is what people should really hear about more. Maura, thank you from the League of Women Voters. Thank you to the callers. Thank you to Adam. Thank you to Scott and others who called in. Good luck to everyone. Please get out and vote. We need change. We need to have a check and balance, okay, of a legislative branch in the city accordingly. So on that note, Adam, again, I'd like to thank you, and I want to wish everyone to have a splendiferous day.